Tonight on NewsWatch, a diplomatic tsunami. Israel protests the UN's efforts to recognize a Palestinian state. Plus, condoms for kids. One city's health department hands out condoms to children as young as 11. And feeding the family. What's behind the sharply higher prices at the grocery store? All this and tonight on NewsWatch. It's news Israel says poses a grave threat to its security. Good evening, everyone. I'm Wendy Griffith. A United Nations leader believes the Palestinian Authority is ready to become a state. He says the main obstacle is Israel's occupation. It's one of the latest examples of the Palestinian effort to become a state and put international pressure on Israel. CBN News Middle East Bureau Chief Chris Mitchell has tonight's top story from Jerusalem.
Israel's defense minister, Ehud Barak, calls it a diplomatic tsunami. He's talking about the Palestinian Authority's plans in September to get the UN to recognize Palestine as an independent state.
They are now refusing to sit to the table because they think, and maybe rightly so, that they have the support of almost two-thirds of the countries that are represented at the General Assembly, and they can get there some kind of a declaration of an independent state at the General Assembly.
Gabriela Shalev served as Israel's UN ambassador for 2 years. She's sounding the alarm that the PA's move poses a grave threat to her country.
Come September, we are there, I think, if nothing will happen in between, and there are still a few months that we can do many things, we are in for big trouble.
Shalev says the Palestinians may well use an obscure UN resolution to bypass the Security Council, where the U.S. holds veto power.
According to this resolution, 377, if there is not a consensus inside the Security Council, then it goes to the General Assembly, which can take collective measures.
Collective measures could have profound consequences for Israel, including sanctions, boycotts, an arms embargo, and even the use of force. The UN might impose a Palestinian state on Israel and isolate the Jewish state.
If this will happen, we can be considered an occupying power in a state which is working for its independence, and then sanctions can be inflicted on Israel.
That's why Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is under enormous pressure. The left in Israel wants him to make dramatic concessions to the Palestinians. He's also under pressure from Washington, where he will visit next month to meet the president and address the Congress. Most Americans may have already made up their minds. According to a new poll, 51% of U.S. registered voters oppose the Palestinian Authority if it unilaterally declares an independent Palestinian state without a signed peace treaty with Israel. 31% support it. Shalev sees hope in the American people.
The people in the United States are so important for us because they have an influence on the government, on the president, and I think we know, and the Americans know, that still, even after everything that takes place in the Middle East, we are the only democracy in the Middle East, and our values are very much like the values of your founders.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
And John Waggie's here with some analysis. John, this kind of diplomatic pressure on Bibi Netanyahu, it's got to be unprecedented for any world leader. What are his options right now?
Well, Wendy, he doesn't have many, but he does have the bully pulpit in the United States, and he's got a command of the English language because he went to high school here. Just today, Speaker Boehner's office in Washington released a statement saying they will formally invite Netanyahu to address Congress next month in May. He's got to make the case there to the world that Iran is the real threat to our civilization, including Israel, and that how can he negotiate peace for a Palestinian state with someone who won't recognize a Jewish state. And that's what Mahmoud Abbas refuses to do. Not only that, he refuses to come to the bargaining table. So he's got a lot at stake when he comes in May.
Now, with all this talk about forming a Palestinian state, no one's talking much about Hamas in Gaza. Of course, most people know they're a terrorist group. How do you integrate a group like that into statehood, into the peace process?
Well, and that's the big question that's being left unaddressed by the Europeans, by the Obama administration. Hamas just doesn't get mentioned. Behind the scenes, there are unity talks going on between the PA and Hamas, or at least they try to get that started. But Hamas really doesn't want to see this go forward. And that may be part of the reason why we've seen rockets coming into Israel, is because Hamas is trying to disrupt the process.
Now, let's talk about Syria. It's not getting much media play, hardly any, but there are some serious demonstrations going on in the streets there against their president, Assad.
Yes, the major media are not covering Syria the way they did Libya, Egypt, Tunisia, and there are people being killed in the streets of Syria, and there is a real threat to the Assad regime, and tomorrow may be a big day for that because the riots have reached the second largest city, Aleppo, in Syria, and if they go on tomorrow, there could be more violence. The government has been firing on the demonstrators.
It's been like a big domino effect in the Middle East. John, thanks for keeping an eye on us. We appreciate it. Well, after threats of a shutdown and intense negotiations, members of the House of Representatives passed a budget today. The budget was supposed to cut $38 billion in federal spending, but as John Jessup tells us, that may not be the case.
The tough job going into Thursday's vote was corralling enough Republicans to support it. Remember, 28 Republicans, House Republicans, voted against its very premise last Friday, and that was to avoid a government shutdown. They were originally sold on the measure as saving around $38 billion in government spending, but ahead of the vote, they discovered that the savings were much more disappointing.
This is a 15-minute vote.
By a vote of 260 to 167, the House approved a budget for the rest of this fiscal year, but not without losing nearly 60 Republicans. When President Obama, John Boehner, and Harry Reid announced the budget deal, they claimed historic savings. But new numbers from the Congressional Budget Office show less than 1% of that money would be produced in the savings promised by the end of the budget year, just $352 million. And when you factor in emergency spending on Iraq and Afghanistan, spending actually goes up by $3 billion more than original estimates. Still, Republicans and Democrats alike were eager to move on and send the budget to their counterparts in the Senate.
I just want this bill over with.
I'm with you. Let's get it over.
The victory, or at least one major victory from the continuing resolution, is that it comes with a requirement for the Senate to take an up or down vote on two critical issues for conservatives. One, defunding Planned Parenthood, and the other, repealing Obamacare. That'll give Republicans more ammunition as they head into 2012 to make bigger gains in the House of Representatives and in the Senate, and also create an opportunity for them to make a bigger dent on deficit spending and the national debt. John Jessup, CBN News, Capitol Hill.
Many parents in Philadelphia are outraged at a new free condom campaign. It targets kids as young as 11. It allows kids and teens to order free condoms online. It's done through a city health department website. The goal is to reduce sexually transmitted diseases. The site includes details about different STDs and ways to prevent them. It also includes instructions for young girls on how to use female condoms. But many parents are especially outraged the campaign includes 11-year-olds, saying that's too young to start getting physical. And Dr. Linda Mintel is back with us. She's an author and family therapist. Linda, is it wrong to give 11-year-olds condoms?
When I see an 11-year-old talking about being sexually active and dealing with STDs, you usually look for things like sexual abuse in their background, exposure to pornography, or some kind of sexual situation that is not age appropriate. Yes, it's wrong because this is not the root, giving somebody a condom when there probably are deep-seated family issues or something going on in that family system that needs to be addressed. Condoms for free is not going to solve those problems.
Now, Philadelphia, I didn't know this, has one of the highest rates of STDs of all our cities. So what's the best way for them to tackle this? Certainly not giving condoms to 11-year-olds.
Well, again, the implication always is that if we give more education to kids younger ages, that somehow that's going to stop all of this from happening. And again, we're not getting to the root of these problems. We live in a society where morality is no longer even discussed on most mainstream media, where kids are exposed nonstop to sexual images every single day, and sex is glorified in our media, and rarely are the consequences, such as an STD or a pregnancy, shown in the media. So trying to tackle this from an educational point of view is ridiculous when that's not what the root of the problem is.
Now, we went to their website. We could only find one sentence that included the word abstinence. But they didn't explain what abstinence was. What does your experience tell you? Does abstinence education work?
Well, abstinence education has its problems too, and it doesn't always show that the direct result of that is that kids are not are abstaining. So again, where is the problem? The problem is usually in the family system. It's usually in the lack of morality. It's usually because of the exposure of media. So we have all these things going on that nobody wants to address, and they want to continue to throw educational things at us as if that is somehow going to solve the problem. It's not working on a number of areas. Bullying is one that comes to mind. It certainly isn't going to work for helping kids deal with their sexuality.
What do you think is in their mind when they're targeting 11-year-olds for condoms?
I'm sure that the health educators are trying to think, I really believe that somehow if they talk to these kids, they're trying to give them some way to stop this from going on. But they're really, again, I don't know what's going on in their mind, because that would be the last thing that I would do as a parent. I would want to talk to my child and know what's going on in the mind of my child and deal with my child directly, not send them to a website and have them ordering free condoms. It's ridiculous.
And, of course, in the inner cities, things get started younger and younger every year. Linda, we appreciate your insights as always.
Thank you.
Thank you. Coming up, flying blind. The FAA chief is angry about more reports of airport control tower problems.
If you're an individual, group, or business needing a dental plan, Avia Dental offers group plans for as little as $5 per month. Now members of your group can save up to 50% or more off of high-quality dental care. Everyone qualifies, and there's no waiting or limits on visits to the dentist. Visit aviadental.com or call 1-888-431-CARE. Avia Dental since 1994. Smile, you're with people who care.
Attention investors, now is the time to protect your retirement accounts and investments.
Excessive government spending is devaluing the U.S. dollar, and high rates of inflation are coming. Gold has tripled since 2001, and some experts predict the prices will climb another 100%. Buy gold now, direct and wholesale, with United Gold Group. The demand for gold around the world is higher than ever. Foreign countries like China and India are buying up gold at record rates. Why? What do they know that you don't?
Call now and get your Gold Investors Kit absolutely free. Call in the next 5 minutes and receive The Secret to Owning Gold in Your Retirement Account, also absolutely free. Just call 1-800-758-5070. That's 1-800-758-5070.
This could be the most important call you make this year. United Gold Group, investing in America's future.
If you're an individual, group, or business needing a dental plan, Avia Dental offers group plans for as little as $5 per month. Now members of your group can save up to 50% or more off of high-quality dental care. Everyone qualifies, and there's no waiting or limits on visits to the dentist. Visit aviadental.com or call 1-888-431-CARE. Avia Dental since 1994. Smile, you're with people who care.
Advocates of sexual assault victims say the trauma is even worse when it happens in the military. They say the crimes are underreported, and when they are, the victims are mistreated. It's reported some 19,000 troops were attacked sexually last year. Now, several members of Congress want to be sure they have certain rights and protections. They introduced a bill with a military women's advocacy group and talked about recent assault cases. One of them was the tragic story behind the murder of Lance Corporal Maria Lauterbach.
She came forward to report that she had been sexually assaulted by a senior enlisted member in her unit. She was then forced to serve with her alleged assailant for the following 8 months before he attacked and killed her and her unborn child and buried them in his backyard.
On SWAN's helpline last year, we got a crisis call from a young Marine named Nicole. Nicole had recently been raped. Her perpetrator had drugged her, and she woke up in the middle of her attack, horrified. She'd only been a Marine for a few months, but what she had to endure after the rape was in many ways worse than the rape itself.
Prosecutors take some 40% of civilian sexual assault cases to court. Only 8% of military cases end up going to trial. Another embarrassment for America's air traffic controllers, the fallout this time included the resignation of a top FAA official. Hank Krakowski was the head of the agency's air traffic organization. He quit after the latest disclosure of a sleeping air traffic controller. It happened yesterday in Reno, Nevada. An emergency medical plane carrying a patient circled the airport waiting for clearance. It eventually had to land on its own at its own risk when it couldn't get a response from the tower. The patient survived.
I will make the guarantee tonight that there's two controllers in these control towers and that it will be safe to fly in and out of these airports.
Congressman John Mica, House Transportation Committee, criticized the plan. He says, quote, only in the federal government would you double up on workers that aren't doing their job. Well, Tea Party and libertarian groups are waging a grassroots campaign for a new movie that comes out Friday. It's based on one of history's most influential novels. Paul Strand went to the Hollywood premiere.
Alice Shrugged is based on the first third of one of the favorite all-time novels of Tea Party types, libertarians, and hardcore capitalists. A handsome steelmaker and beautiful railroad magnate fight collectivist and scheming lefty politicians to save a crumbling America. It gets its PG-13 rating from adultery, one cuss, and a couple of sexy scenes, no racier than what you might see on the WB. The novel's author, Ayn Rand, was an atheist but pushed a morality based on freedom and individual responsibility that's captured the heart of many on the right. The main producer's son was brought up a Randian atheist, but is now a Christian trying to bring Christians together with Rand where possible.
The stand for individual liberty, the stand for absolute moral values, that while there's some disagreement, there's a lot of overlap.
The movie's makers are so far out of the Hollywood mainstream, they held what they called the Hollywood premiere here in Washington. It's opening on only about 300 screens, and its producers say if you want to see it, you need to go online and demand it come to your community. But they desperately want you to see it and be emboldened. Lead producer John Aglialoro, a lifelong disciple of Rand's objectivist philosophy, believes all who want a strong, thriving, free America must come together to save their nation as it slides towards socialism and a weak-kneed, welfare-minded liberalism.
Benjamin Franklin said, hang separately or hang together. We need Christians to join with the philosophy of objectivists, and let's together regain our country back again.
Atlas Shrugged so perfectly fits the philosophy of most Tea Party members, this might be the first movie to make them swoon like teen girls going to see one of those Twilight movies. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from the Atlas Shrugged premiere.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking, came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. we'll see how it goes, we'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they save my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Well, you may have noticed food prices are going up just about everywhere, and that's bad news for Americans who are still struggling in this economy. So what's driving these food prices so high? Charlene Israel explains in tonight's Focus Report.
Like most moms, Tori Jones does her best to keep food in her kitchen cabinets.
It's been hard. It's been really hard. We just try to cut back when we can.
She and her husband Eric say rising food prices, coupled with higher prices at the pump, are putting a strain on the family's food budget.
A few items that we expect to be like $20 or $30 will be double that.
Their monthly grocery bill has shot up dramatically.
Normally $300 to $400, and now easily $4 to $5.
In February, food prices jumped 3.9%. The biggest one-month jump since November 1974.
This is the agriculture futures trading floor at the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, where traders negotiate world commodity prices, including grains like corn and wheat. What happens here will help to determine just how much consumers will pay for things like cereal and bread.
Chris Manns is with the traders group in Chicago.
That box of cornflakes or that box of whatever, loaf of bread, they can now say, well, look here, much like the gasoline stations, we have this problem. We need to increase our prices.
The U.S. Department of Agriculture says the global demand for food has pushed U.S. corn supplies to their lowest levels in 15 years. In just the past 6 months, corn prices have nearly doubled from $3.50 a bushel to nearly $7. Corn affects most food products in stores. It's used to feed cattle, hogs, and chickens that fill the meat aisles. It also sweetens most soft drinks and many other foods.
It's as tight as it's ever been. So any slight twitch or hiccup as far as any side of it goes, and you'll eventually have a price spike.
Economists list several reasons for the higher prices, like recent extreme weather patterns. Here in the U.S.,
it was just been weather problems everywhere. We're at a low level. We're not about to run out of corn, but the carryover is getting down to where we need a good crop this coming year.
Freezing temperatures across southern states sent vegetable prices soaring. 70 to 75% of some lettuce crops were damaged. The result? Higher prices for the produce. The weather problems aren't limited to the U.S. In Russia, the worst drought in half a century has devastated wheat crops. Australia is known for producing a lot of meat, but record floods have hurt output and sent global food prices soaring. In China, the worst drought in 60 years is threatening the wheat crops, although the Chinese government does not admit that there's any food supply problem. Rising food prices have had political implications, too. Rising prices for corn, rice, and wheat back in 2008 sparked riots from Haiti to Egypt. And earlier this year, there were food riots in Tunisia, and unrest toppled leaders in Egypt, the world's largest wheat importer. Many protested dramatic price hikes for basic food staples, such as rice, cereal, cooking oil, and sugar.
In 2008, food riots erupted in 30 countries. In 2011, rising food prices, combined with rising unemployment, have also sparked riots and political unrest.
But there's more to rising food prices than just weather. Dr. Robert Thompson of the Chicago Council on Global Affairs says the rising global population also contributes to food shortages.
We have to feed 78 million more people each year. We've had expansion of the middle class in Asia. That means the demand for food is growing really fast.
A demand that's growing faster than supply.
I project the demand for food will double in the world in the next 40 years. And with only 10% more land to grow it on and less water available to the world's farmers, I think we're likely to see continued long-term upward trend in commodity prices.
So it looks like higher food prices will be with us for a while.
I think that the era of cheap food prices is over. Meat prices are going to go up, and corn prices are probably going to stay up for at least the next 2 to 3 years.
That has some turning to planting their own food. And families like the Joneses keep looking for ways to make ends meet.
I'm a stay-at-home mom, but I might actually have to get a job, and maybe we depend on family members to help watch the kids if things continue to get out of hand.
Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Up next, sensory-friendly movies, new theaters that allow talking, running around, and they even keep the volume low for a very special crowd.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was gonna be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were gonna die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. And I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking. Came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they save my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
For parents of children with disabilities, it's not always easy to do common things like go to the mall or go to the movies. But one Massachusetts theater is trying to change that. Chunky Cinema Pub, a restaurant-style movie theater, has started offering sensory-friendly movie screenings. They give kids with special needs like autism and Down syndrome an opportunity they typically wouldn't have. During the screenings, the lights are left on, the sound is kept low, and kids are free to walk around and make as much noise as they want. Those differences help to minimize the sensory overload that normally prevents special needs children from having a movie theater experience.
I usually end up missing 15 minutes at a time because he wants to run around, and I have to bring him out and calm down. It's a good chance for my son to come and just be able to enjoy it the way he wants to instead of the way other people regulate it.
Yeah, sometimes we all want to run around the theater. Well, the movie theater got the idea for sensory-friendly screenings after someone posted their Facebook page. They say that though they're aimed at special needs children, anyone is welcome. Looks like a lot of fun. Well, that's going to do it for this edition of NewsWatch. Thanks so much for watching. And remember, you can always email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com. We hope you'll join us next time. See you next time, and good night.